So here we're just looking at this particular high data rate signal. Have multiple inputs being modulated onto a WPAN source. And in this case, we just have a gain block for C4, but a modulation going out to our instrumentation. But in the actual simulation, we routed this through this amplifier to look at what kind of results we would be getting if we were to run the signal through the amp. And we can see we've got some constellation output, as well as starting to look at what our EVM would look like for frame error rate EVM. So we're able to measure that per frame. We could have also added spectral mass and things like that. This is just our first check to see that we weren't getting gross levels of EVM, or our constellation wasn't completely turning into a rat's nest or a spider web, something that no longer resembled the constellation. So these are the things we've done to date. Like I say, we're going to continue working on this. So we're interested if people would be interested in some additional videos on this, or coming in and taking a workshop based on this amp, playing around with it and seeing the process, what was done. Or what future steps Agilent could do next to better help you with some of the information and your job at hand. So I want to thank you all for your time, and I think we're going into the question and answer phase now.
Yep, that's right. Great job, Michael. Thank you very much. And we do have a number of questions. Just one more thing, if we push... Michael, do you have one more slide to push? Just we'll fill out the URL for the survey that people can take. I think if you push next one more time. There you go. Okay, so this URL that you see on your screen will take you to a survey that Agilent has prepared to help get some feedback with regards to the presentation and the design kits and more information about EDA software from Agilent. Okay, so our first question, Michael, asks if the design kit, the PDK that was shown, or the design kit itself, has that been validated and available today?
I'll let Ken Mays answer that. He's on the TriQuint side and has more up-to-date knowledge than me.
Thank you, Michael. Yes, that has been fully validated. I mean, we have basically not only the capability of doing the DC and RS and harmonic balance type simulations, but as you saw earlier, it does have the process statistics enabled in it, along with the noise parameters. And of course, as you've seen, it has the full P-cell generator for doing the layout involved with it also.
Okay, great. Thank you, Ken. Our next question asks, some people use Cadence tools for a similar sort of design. How do you compare that with using ADS tools? And I think that might go back to Michael.
Okay. One thing that would be one of your first issues or concerns would be that the current PDKs for Cadence tools only offer linear models. So if you're only going to be doing linear simulation, you would be able to do that, but otherwise you really need the ADS environment to get the nonlinear models, and just having a better understanding of metallization between the different devices. ADS has a full library of those microstrip line models that we were using. Give us a very good idea of what the initial design looks like. It gets us in the ballpark of the design, and at lower frequencies those are perfectly adequate to design with. Then you have an integrated EM simulation or multiple EM simulation engines within the ADS environment, as well as a lot of different techniques for designing amplifiers. Traditionally, most of the power amplifiers and mimics that have been produced have been done in the ADS environment, so it's really peak there. Not taking anything away from the Cadence simulators, the Spectre is a wonderful, it's an industry standard, but it's a time domain engine, and often you're looking at frequency domain effects here, and ADS is just really peak for that.
Okay, yep, great. Our next question, rather a lengthy one. About a new feature to be introduced in ADS 2009 U1, you cascade three times a single block. So a question arises, why didn't you extract with X parameters a single stage to speed up nonlinear checks later? It could have been possible to make measurements, but the NVNA actually does not exceed 50 gigahertz, if I correctly remember, a single stage standalone element to match its layout circuit before cascading everything while retaining linear and nonlinear behavior characteristics. So I guess the question is, why not extract the X parameters of a single stage to speed up the nonlinear checks later?
You certainly could have done that for if you were just staying linear. If you were looking at a power sweep, which is what we're trying to get to, or actually adding a modulated signal, testing a modulated signal where your power is varying as you're modulating, if you go into the nonlinear region, a linear representation of that is just going to look linear. You're not going to see compression. You're not going to see any sort of spectral regrowth or EVM from that. You could have done that. Now, the other way we could have done this was to have extracted a nonlinear model or behavioral model. That would have also been possible. But then again, you're going to be limiting yourself in some cases depending upon that model. So to use full nonlinear models, we had to stay at circuit level. But we could have done that. We could have done exactly what they're saying. And this particular PNA went to 65 gigahertz, and we calibrated out to 65.
Okay, great. Our next question refers to stability. For a power amplifier, is the K of around 1.4 enough, since at 40 gigahertz K is less than zero in your design? Did you observe oscillations?
We didn't see any oscillations. I have a feeling the way we fixed it, we had enough resistance in any feedback path that might have gotten started down there. But that is still one check we want to make, go back and look and see if we can actually get a condition where we can get it to oscillate, seeing that it might. The other thing that we just ran out of time doing was the actual compression of the amplifier. That is also something we want to do. We tried that, but we were having trouble getting a good cal on that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Our next question I think probably needs some clarification here. I'll paraphrase. The person who wrote in just announces that he's designing CMOS transistors and would like to implement this kind of transistor on Momentum. Is it possible to implement, and what kind of tools do I have to use for this implementation?
Well, Momentum and EM simulation engines are passive analysis engines, so I'm able to look at the metallization, the stack-ups. The one thing I'm not going to be able to analyze, obviously, is the active region of the device itself. But if I want to look at any sort of striping manifolds, things going up to the device, the manifold or power divider coming out of the device, all of those things I can set up and run in many of the CMOS foundries, such as TSMC, and others have qualified Momentum stack-ups that you're able to get depending upon the process, and that will set you up for the metallization runs. As far as the devices go, you're relying on the foundry to provide you a good model for that. And that does have some problems depending upon if my metallization around my device has gotten so close that I do have coupling to fingers between that metallization and actual fingers on the device. There's not really a good solution for that in industry right now.
Okay. Our next question asks, why don't you put a microchip T for the gate-drain feedback on gate and drain terminals? I might assume that the extracted model of the active device de-embeds any other parasitic, so I don't figure how you are sure you could directly add the feedback to the device terminals.
Could you read that one more?
Sure. The question is asking why you didn't put a microchip T for the gate drain feedback on the gate and drain terminals. And I might assume that the extracted model of the active device de-embeds any other parasitic.
Okay, because the way the T cell or the model was set up for that area, that's a very good question. I'm actually getting onto the gate and the source of the gate of the drain of the device of the P cell, and I didn't want to flatten that out and break it up. So putting a T that close to the device itself, you're now putting some parasitics that's assuming, the T is assuming that you have a nice TEM wave going into it. That's not going to be true anymore. So those T models wouldn't be very accurate there. And this is one of those cases where, if I can